All right, good afternoon, everybody. And I must say a very special thank you for that very kind introduction, because I've been trying and working, but not really trying to get attention, just making sure that I do exactly what I'm supposed to do so that at the end of it, everybody could benefit. I value students' time, and of course, everybody else's time very much. So that when we share time together, it means that it will be productive and you would have benefited from this time. All right, so without any delay, I would like to get started so that I would not keep you here very long. Of course, I've chosen to speak about something very interesting, which is, of course, the marriage between technology and neuroscience. And it is good for us to appreciate what has been done by all the engineers in order to facilitate our understanding of neuroscience. And of course, understand that neuroscience is indeed the study of the structure and function of the brain. Now, I want you to pay careful attention to that structure and function. There is a lot of research about the structure of the brain. And we know down to a millimeter level and possibly down to a synaptic level how the brain is structured. But the big question is, how is it functioning? What constitutes a single thought? And we all have like 70,000 plus thoughts a day. What is the brain map of that simple thing as one thought that rests in your mind for about 10 seconds or less? But what is even more important is that when someone has a neurological disease, it's a catastrophe. It's usually debilitating. It is usually incurable. And for that reason, I choose to follow this field of neuroscience. And I want to actually share as much as I can about neuroscience. So to really fully appreciate the brain, we have to study it a little bit, right? At least for this talk. So within your brain, there's about 100 billion neurons. And each of those neurons actually make a connection called a synapse. The gap in a synapse is about 200 millionths of a millimeter. So again, the idea is really small. And there are over 1,000 trillion synapses. But throughout life, as we are awake, or even when we are sleeping, there's a precise communication throughout this brain. And of course, if it's offset, then of course you start to lose memory, or with Parkinson's disease, you start to lose motor function, or with other diseases, you become incapacitated. So actually, the brain, and of course this is obvious, we know it facilitates who we are and what we are. Our identity rests in the full functioning of our brain. This is just to give you a little idea that the brain initially was thought as just a lump of fat weighing about 1.5 kilograms. And I will take you on a journey this afternoon from what they first thought about the brain, 6000 BC, to what we think about the brain, 2016. As quickly as I can, of course. But it's a very intense story. And I've left out much of it, of course, but I've tried to keep the most interesting thing. As you look at these pictures, you will begin to appreciate, and of course the anatomy students have to study the little details that you can't see, right? That the brain itself now is not just a lump of fat. Every elevation, a gyrus, and every crest in that brain has a specific function. And we didn't know this before, and we're still actually struggling to figure it out. There were a few clues here and there that it had something to do, and I'll actually highlight three of those classic clues that were actually produced by human beings who had some catastrophic accident, and we were able to study them while they were alive and after they died. Well, at least two of them, right? The other one, luckily, he's still living, but he's the most interesting. I left him down for the last, because the most interesting thing about him is that he falls in love about 1,000 times a day. And I'll explain that to you, all right? So this is what the brain actually looks like with our neuroimaging technology. Now, the biomedical engineering technology I'm talking about, I'm zoning in because there's so much technology for neuroscience. I'm basically zoning into one type of technology, which is neuroimaging, right? We're not going into the molecular level to understand how neurotransmitters and receptors and stuff function. So this is like probably 5% of the entire field of neuroscience, but it's an intense field with a very exciting history. Now, I'll start with what we know today, And what we, what technologies we have available, and of course there's not a comprehensive list, this is just the common ones. We use CT, MRI, fMRI, PET, SPECT, EEG, and MEGs, MEG, in order to understand how the brain works. And of course, these technologies are very, very elaborate. But even though they are so elaborate, we still cannot unfold diseases like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's and dementia and schizophrenia and depression. We could only watch it happening in motion through these recording modalities, but we can't actually intervene just yet. So there's a whole lot more to do, and there's a huge drive, you know, to get this stuff done, right? Now, one of the biggest problems with actually investigating the brain has to do with the skull. See the skull, it's very thick, this cranium. So in order to understand how the brain works, you have to get past this cranium, right? With other organs outside the skull, obviously, you could dissect it out very easily, or you could slice in and take a peek and see how it works. But not so with the brain, because once you break that barrier, there's a whole host of infections. And of course, a patient doesn't usually survive much longer. So the journey I'm gonna take you on now will start 6000 BC. There's some interesting things that happened, right? During the Stone Age period, of course we calculate backwards, but archaeological finds around the world discovered, like in the 18th century, 1800s, that there were like 1,500 skulls scattered around the world, and these skulls had holes in them. Now, what was interesting about the holes? Well, they didn't figure it out just yet. They were just collecting them and thinking those were holes from battle scars, right? Like, they were, I mean, a Stone Age, everybody had a big stone like hitting everybody in the head. Cracks in the skull, common thing, right? But recently, one of our brilliant anatomists, Paul Broca, he actually studied the edges and he realized, hey, I mean, you could even see it at a glance. It looks rounded. It wasn't post-mortem, meaning after the person got struck, they died, but it actually had time to heal. So what did that tell us? Back in 6000 BC, people were actually cutting through the skulls to look at the brain, right? And the reason is, of course, we don't know because, I mean, 6000 BC, right? But even then, man was inquisitive about the brain. There are some ideas that this was done to relieve pain after injury or to allow evil spirits to escape the body and that sort of thing, right? So there are many explanations for this, but of course we'll never know. Now, I'm talking about neuroimaging, and let's look at the first set of tools. Obviously, to cut those holes in the skull, you had to use stones. The guy Paul Broca, when he was studying the skull, he took a human skull with a stone and it took 10 hours to cut it. So imagine what type of anesthetic they had back then. Probably nothing. So, interesting. This type of cutting through the skull to look at the brain, that's called trepanation. And this trepanation thing actually continued, and some people actually do it today still, because they have a belief that the brain is limited by this cranium. And if you actually increase the volume that the brain could occupy, then it could have more brain matter and then you'll get smarter. But they should try reading a book. Anyhow, so the first set of tools were actually the stones. Now, this was the second set of neurosurgical tools to actually cut into the skull and look at the brain, right? And there's a famous picture where this guy is actually having someone do this trepanation type surgery on him. All right, we move forward now to like 1600 BC. With the Egyptians. Now, if you follow this, the Egyptians actually had a book where they did some very good documentation of the structure of the brain. Very, very good detail, right? Because they were studying the anatomy of the brain avidly. But something strange, it didn't connect, because here now, they actually believed that the brain was actually involved in pumping blood through the body. And the brain was not the seat of intelligence. So the objective was lost, it wasn't met. And of course, when they were creating their mummies, they had this interesting little hook that they would use to pull the brain out of the nose and get rid of it from their mummies because it was considered to be so useless. I read once that they thought that it was just an organ to produce, not by the Egyptians, of course. So we're jumping forward a little bit now. So I'm gonna speed up a little bit because what happens here now, we into like 500 BC and you're gonna see something interesting that certain interesting and well-known people were now making comments, and these comments were sealed in history. What was the most interesting thing, though? Hippocrates and Plato they both were along the same line that it had something to do with epilepsy, okay, so that's the brain control in the body, something to do with the optic nerve, right? So they actually appreciated that the brain is involved in seeing. And of course, Plato said, he was like one of the first guys to write it down, make it documented, so to speak, that the brain was associated with intelligence, right? Much of us think Aristotle is great, but Aristotle actually was still a guy thinking the brain is just a radiator for heat when the body got hot. So he was like still off point. Anyhow, jumping through to 1700s, what you will see here, of course I don't expect to read it, I'm going to tell you about it. All these are things that were documented throughout this part of the history about the external structure of the brain. So far, no one really had a clue how it works. So we're jumping forward now into the 1600s. And of course, I'm trying to show you the tools that they were using for imaging. So how did they figure out all of this was basically through postmortem studies, right? They would take their cadavers, slice them up carefully, and look at the structures. And if the structures were common in a lot of people, then they would document it and actually give it a name. So that's what was going on. Everybody was excited about dissecting the brain and coming up with all these labels. And these were the tools now in the 1600s, right? So had more elaborate saws and cutting tools and whatever. Now, in 1848, something very interesting happened. And this is the first classical study of understanding the function of a brain. So Phineas Gage, he was a guy who actually would plant dynamite when they were building roads. So if they wanted to clear out a big stone, he was a guy that would go hammer down this really long tamping iron, they call it, because it is like a long chisel, really. So he would make a hole in the ground below the rock, and then he would use the same tamping iron to push the dynamite down, and then he would use the same tamping iron to cover it up with soil, and then they would ignite it, right? Basic dynamite stuff. But when he was doing it, and something happened, and the dynamite exploded, and this tamping iron actually went through his head. Now, it was quite interesting, because right after the accident, the tamping iron was taken out, and he was walking around with a big hole in his head, not knowing or not feeling any pain. The brain itself doesn't feel any pain, right? So quite interesting. He lived for about 12 years afterwards, after his surgery, and his eye was patched up and stuff. And this is him. He lost an eye, but this is his open eye. Well, that's the best picture I could get of him. But the idea is, he lost a significant part of his brain, but he was still functioning. But they followed him throughout the next 12 years, and they realized he became very unsociable. He lost the capability to socialize, and that's when they first learned, aha, there is something to do with function in this part of the brain, the frontal cortex. So he became one of the classical examples or confirmation that the brain had something to do with social behavior and thinking. Because he could function, he did go back to work like this, and he did function for up to 12 years, right? But he lost that part of the frontal cortex that they first begin used to start documenting now structure and function of the brain. Jumping forward, we're now into the 1900s. And of course, many of you engineers and stuff, because you use x-rays to analyze concrete and steel and stuff, we use it to analyze people. This guy, William Rentgen, he, of course, was the discoverer of X-ray. And really and truly, 1900 marked the transformation of neuroimaging, because now we could peek in. But the peek we got was a very horrible peek. It didn't actually change much. So to tell you a little bit about William Rentgen and what he was doing, is a picture of his lab. He had this cathode ray thing, and of course, his students know about this. And he was experimenting with it. And the objective at that point in time was to actually see how far the ray could go. And they knew it couldn't travel very far. But while he was experimenting with it here, he had like a cardboard leaned up with a material pasted on it that could fluoresce for another experiment. But when he was experimenting in the dark, he saw it fluorescing. And he knew the cathode rays couldn't travel that far. So something else was actually causing this. So he immediately got excited. And this was a guy, when he was onto something, he locked in. So basically he stayed in his lab for 7 weeks. And you know, became very unsociable as well, because he lost brain matter. But he was working on something, right? And he eventually documented this thing really well. And when he saw what it was, or what it could do, because he didn't know what it was, so that's how he called it, the X-ray, the unknown ray, right? And since then, of course, 1900s, it stuck. Now, he figured out that while trying to move around the screen and check how far it is, he realized he could see on the screen his bones. So the X-ray now could actually penetrate structures that light couldn't penetrate. So that was the most exciting thing, right? Eventually, now, This was the tube he was using, this early Crookes X-ray tube, a very basic thing, but the idea is it had to be a vacuum inside, and in order to create the vacuum, and they were looking at when high electric currents were being passed across a vacuum. All right, I wouldn't go into details of the X-ray itself, right? Of course, a lot of work went in later on. This is the modern X-ray tube, not this one, because it had a lot of heating problems and the X-ray beam was really poor. But here you can see actually a small example, a quick look at what transformed the world. And you'd find this in all CT machines present today, right? And you can see it's glowing here. Heat transfer was a big problem, right? Now, after he documented this, obviously he wanted to share this idea. So he called his wife into the lab and he basically X-rayed her hand. And this picture here of his wife's hand with that ring is one of the most famous pictures when it comes to X-rays. She was the first person to actually have an X-ray, but she actually panicked because it, you know, everybody was like mythical stuff and evil stuff and whatever, right? And of course, there's a documentation, a paper coming out in 1896, right? Kind of talking about what he was doing. But the official release of the X-ray machine to the public was like in the 1905, 1901, right? Of course, he was given, and this is why this guy is so exciting, because he was the first guy to receive the Nobel Prize in physics ever in history. So he then started this trend, which of course, ever since scientists have been trying to get a Nobel Prize. Of course, all of this did not happen without some intrigue and excitement and chaos, because this guy, Philip Leonard, it was his cathode tube that Rentgen discovered the X-ray with. So therefore, he wanted this Nobel Prize first in 1901. So for the next 4 years, there was a lot of quarrel back and forth. They couldn't talk. He negated everything about the X-ray and thought it was rubbish. In the meantime, though, people were going crazy with this commercially available X-ray that came out in 1901. It was so crazy that if you wanted to see if your shoe fit properly, shoe stores actually had X-ray machines, so they would X-ray a foot in the shoe. So if you look it up, you'll see plenty X-rays of people's foot. Now, I was kind of lost at the beginning, but then I understood why. And then there was this other guy. He X-rayed his head to show his customers that you could actually X-ray a head. Quite soon afterwards, like within 1 week they started doing this, obviously everybody started suffering from X-ray burns. So then the documentation of the effects, now the bad effects of ionizing radiation started. You know, of course it wasn't reversible. These people actually developed facial cancer, cancers in their hands, legs, whatever. All right, moving forward though. Even though the X-ray came out and it was exciting, in medicine it caused many other fields to progress really fast. But when it came to neuroimaging, we were still at park. We didn't move, you know why? Because of this. This cranium, again, is in the way. And of course, when you X-ray the head, because the bone absorbs the ionizing radiation so well, it can penetrate. So you could barely see. Now, of course, those guys were using really, really large amounts of X-ray. Eventually, later on, they realized that if you cut it down, then you could actually start to see shadows. But it's like if you're shining a bright light on a candle, you mightn't see the candle, but of course if you reduce the light, then you're gonna see the candle, right? So the candle is like the brain tissue on the inside. So up to that point, 19-something, we couldn't see inside the brain. So a great guy, an ingenious guy, he came up with a solution to that. But before we get to that solution, of course, there's chaos in history. And what some guys did, they were so desperate to get a Nobel Prize, you know, they wanted to be the first person to fully image the brain using X-ray. So they produced this picture. This picture is actually of cat guts with magnesium, something in it, in a kind of circular dish. Eventually, of course, it was thrown out because it didn't look. You see, they thought that once you had elevations and crests, it's a brain. But of course, every time you do postmortem studies, these elevation and crests have a precise geometry. It's not just anywhere. So that was thrown out. Now we get to this thing called neuroencephalography. What one guy discovered is that if you put air into the brain, it would increase the contrast. Of course, air doesn't absorb X-rays, right? So what they decided to do, and of course, from here now, I'm totally all in respect for ladies. The first picture is the X-ray of a lady's hand. The first neuroencephalography was done of a woman. You'll see the first woman to put her head in a CT machine. You know, they've all been documented in history. And it's quite interesting that they were brave. Okay, that's my interpretation of this. So just watch this clip, and this clip will explain.
Now, there's going to be a little pain in your
head. A little pain in your head. Because he's going to put air into her brain through her spine. That's not the hard part yet.
Which is an air study that people
but they need
about.
To move the air around in your head by tilting you in all different directions. So he has an X-ray machine there, and he's going to hit us several doses of high ionizing radiation to take these pictures. Yikes. So you'll see in 1 minute, because a 1 minute clip, she's going to have three X-rays, high ionizing radiation, right? So he was kind of like, she already have a tumor. And that's what he's trying to see, right? And he's going to give her cancer, technically, after solving the tumor problem. At least we can see it, right? So he's going to take the X-ray to her in that position. So that puts the air towards the back, so it bubbles up. And then he's going to take the X-ray in another position. And the air will bubble again somewhere else. And he's going to do that. Now, consider these people with tumors in their brain. They're already suffering from headaches and pressures and stuff. So you realize this was not a good solution. It was just the next step. It didn't really produce much. Okay? Now, these are the pictures that he was able to get, though. It did help, because if you look here, you will actually see this kind of mass dotted out there, right? And that's her cystuna cyst. So she did have a mass, and well, it wasn't like the image before where you couldn't see anything. Now you could actually have a little idea of something in her brain, right? So now, confirmation, you could go do surgery, right? You didn't want to like pry open her cranium and realize, oh, everything looks fine, because you can't like part the sulcus and gyrus. You can't do that with the brain. You could go into the ventricle of the heart, right? Or you could look at the lungs and probably snip out a little piece and it work fine, but not with the brain. And I'll show you HM. They thought they could have cut out parts of people's brains and you'll be fine. Not true. And HM is the next classic example coming up to the end. All right, so we're jumping forward now to the CT scanner. The CT scanner in 1971. So we jumped 70-something years with not actually being able to see the brain properly to do neuroimaging. All right, so short story here now. Godfrey Hounsfield, he's the guy. And of course, together with Jamie Ambrose, who actually produced the first CT machine. Now, a lot of engineering went into this and a lot of planning and a lot of chaos also. Now, background, Alan Cormack is the guy who actually drew the plans, and he is the mastermind. You can see it in his face. He's the mathematician and the physician who actually designed everything. Now, Godfrey Hounsfield, you won't believe was his background. He was a musician who actually was part of EMI Industries. Anybody know about EMI? Anyhow, that was the Beatles recording company. Okay, so he was working for the Beatles, and then all of a sudden, he started having these ideas that you could use X-rays to do 3D imaging, meaning that if you took many pictures of a particular object from different sides, you could recreate a three-dimensional object, right? So he started having these images, but he was thinking about doing it with just solid objects, which he did test first. But then eventually now, well, him and Ambrose, they got together and decided, hey, we could use this for soft tissue. So they actually started using soft tissue, and of course, the race was to look at the brain. So they would go out to like abattoirs and stuff and collect brains, and of course it didn't have nice styrofoam and ice box and whatever, so you're walking around with animal brains and then going to the lab. And preservatives was not good because you wanted to look at the fresh brain, but if you know anything about brains, it rots kind of fast, right? So that was a big problem, to travel around, get the brains, do the experiments and whatever. Anyhow, in science and in history, they did recognize the correct two people for developing the CT. So Alan Cormack and Godfrey Hounsfield did get the Nobel Prize, and not Jamie Ambrose, because Jamie Ambrose was like the understudy for Godfrey Hounsfield, right? And this is a picture of the first machine that they created. Again, a woman putting her head into this machine. She has no clue what's going to do, really, because of course it's only over time you can document the negative effects. But by this time, though, they did know X-ray and ionizing radiation was bad for health. So of course, but she did have a brain tumor, and of course you could see it here. Now, one thing to note about this, and this is what will now control the next stage in history. This image, of course, is very blurry. As you can see, it's like an old newspaper print, right? It does not have high resolution. So the drive now was to improve two things. How close you could get to look at two objects when they're very close. So that's spatial resolution. But then, remember in the beginning I showed you structural and functional. How quick you could actually collect data from the brain is called temporal resolution. So you'll see some imaging techniques is for spatial and some is for temporal. So like when a neuron fires, it fires really fast, right? So if you want to actually measure something based on how it's firing, you need something that could collect data really fast. So that's temporal resolution. But so far, we wouldn't catch up to that for a little while. And, because this is the area of CT, right? So it was a lot more spatial. So the next drive was to get this machine now to produce a high-resolution picture. Now, the interesting thing is, the reason why Hounsfield was able to do this is because he was well-funded by the Beatles. In the 1960s, the Beatles were well on their way to being the most successful band ever in history, and they were making a whole lot of money. And like I said, he was working with this group, and they actually, because they had so much money and they were successful, they allowed him and they funded him to actually develop this machine he was dreaming about, because it sounded plausible. And of course, he was linked with Alan Cormack, who was a mastermind. So they did supply all the funding. Of course, nobody actually wanted to develop it, you know. So he had to go to one lab and another lab and look around until one lab did actually allow him to create it. And because of the heavy funding, things accelerated really fast. Now, what they did, though, they were really smart about it, because back then, everyone knew about patents, and I don't think it was that expensive. So they quickly patented, and they controlled the market for the next 10 years for CT scanners. Now, during that 10 years, they evolved the machine like 4 or 5 times. So when they finally released it to the public, when they gave up the license, because other companies actually now wanted to commercialize the use of it, because by the time they finished with it in 10 years, it was all the way around the world. And the demand for it was high, because even currently today, there are approximately 60 million CTs that are done just in the US alone. So many, right? And of course, well, by the end of the talk, you'll understand why it's not such of a good thing to do so many CT scans, right? Okay, so this first machine, they use a very thin X-ray, because now they realize that if you cut down the dose, the amount of the X-ray, you could actually get good contrast, right? But this machine was called the translate rotate. What it would do, it would beam the X-ray here, take a picture, then take a picture, and it would do that, and then it would go 1 degree, and then do that again until it completed 180 degrees, taking over 2.5 hours. Now, the computer they had to support this machine, first of all, the first version, it was off-site. So the data had to go via telephone lines to this, what they call a mega computer, right? And it really was a mega computer. And if you saw their mini computer was probably big like this table. So, but anyhow, they were very proud of it in the second generation, right? So the first machine was the translate rotate. And this actually shows you how it worked a little bit, translate rotate. This is actually a fast version of it. But what they would do now, just imagine you're getting so many X-rays repeatedly and it's going around your head. But it did improve. And what you would see here is like the little pencil beam that it actually used, right? Now the second version, this is actually I think one of the first 5 people to actually be X-rayed. So these 5 people went down in history for being the first set of people to actually have their brains assessed and have successful surgeries, right? Now what I want you to appreciate is that you have to stay in that machine for like 2.5 hours in the first versions and not move. So obviously if you move now, that would create a blurred image, right? So many challenges towards getting this good brain picture. So obviously they were never satisfied and they kept going and going and going. And you can see in the background, you see it will start to rotate and translate. That's it kind of shifting a little bit at a time, a little bit, 1 degree until it completed 180 degrees. Now they had a problem though, it was hardwired. So therefore it couldn't spin, right? So it had to actually go to 180 degrees and stop. Right, it couldn't go right around the head, if you know about modern CT, which you will see in a little bit. Now, the second generation, they actually, instead of using a pencil beam, they, again, engineered it to the wide angle. And of course, the one of the reasons why I want to give this talk here to the engineering body is because I want to pay due respect to all these engineers who are facilitating the field of medicine and of course, improving the life and the health of people, you know. And the second machine now worked pretty much the same way, translate, rotate. But now it was a little faster because it actually covered a wider area of the brain in one picture, right? Third generation. So they came up with something a bit ingenious where they use a wider beam, a fan beam. And of course now the concept of the moving table actually came in. So we're kind of moving away from only head scanners now to full body scanners. So vision is opening, the machine is evolving, right? And you can see the wide beam now. And what you have now is a rotate where it could actually do 180 degrees much faster. So you realize by the time we got to third generation, the 2.5 hours had been cut down, right? And of course, it could do slices throughout the body now, so the machine is evolving. This is a picture now of the third generation scanner where it had a really wide beam. This is the detector, and this is the X-ray emitter, right? And pretty much this is how the new machine is working now. It's actually spinning round and round continuously. Why? Because the engineers came up with a sliding ring technology, where a slip ring technology, where the contacts were not hardwired, but they were actually slipping on a ring, so that the machine now could revolve 360 degrees continuously, and therefore cutting down the time for CT scans even less. So all of this is exciting. And then, of course, another design was to actually have two X-ray sources to cut the time down in half. So it's going, and of course, this is just showing you how the real CT scanner version 3, at the end of all of that, the speed you can attain under the cover. So that's slow speed. And then, of course, this is full speed. So this is why the CT scanner now could actually take a CT scan of your whole body in 2 minutes, because of this. Now, when you're under the cover, you're really not realizing that apparatus is rotating around you, right? So some drawbacks. People who are claustrophobic now, because of all of this humming noise, it's loud inside there, right? They're kind of worried, you know. Some part come loose and hurt them. Anyhow, fourth generation, things kept improving. The fifth generation was, you know, this was around the time when they wanted to give up the license. You know, 10 years has passed. But with the fifth generation, they actually came up with a technique where the X-ray source actually was not rotating. Neither was the detector. So this is a fixed scenario, where they simply use a deflection coil, and what the deflection coil would do, it would reflect the X-ray round and round and round, right? So you see, it's actually fixed, and it's only the X-ray beam that's moving. So no more moving parts, no more big humming, right? But there were some limitations to this, and they did have to go back to the other version, because the modern day version does have a camera and a detector that is spinning around you. Because with that design, there was a flow. And now what we have is not one beam, but we have this wide multi-slice beam with a multi-slice detector. So when it spirals around you, it's actually covering a wider area. So of course, this is very exciting if you're an engineer and you're understanding this, and you want to learn how a machine can be transformed, right? Okay, the images that we could take now, obviously, not just the little silhouette that we saw with the new flow, the encephalograph that we talk about, but you could actually start to see now structures inside the brain, and it's very important, because if a person has a tumor, you could actually see it well. What we also got now is different planes, because the CT machine, it's a tomographic machine, meaning that what it does, it takes all the slices that the X-ray takes, and a computer algorithm now will generate a three-dimensional image of the brain, and you could actually hop through it in slices. That's what a CT scan does, right? And this kind of shows you that you could start from one point and you could look at sections, sequential sections of the brain now, and also the body, right? And in different planes. So now you could start to do volumetric analysis of tumors, and you can know precisely where it is. Now, neuroscientists and neurosurgeons and these people who are working on tumors and cancers, they really needed this information. So at this level, things really, really transformed, right? Okay. And of course, you could see clearly now the type of image that you could get if there's a tumor. Let's move to something else now, the MRI machine, because I don't want to keep you here too long, right? The MRI machine actually works now on a whole different principle. So you'll see that it has to do with resonance of atoms, and precisely the hydrogen atom. Now what happens with a hydrogen atom when you put it in a magnetic field, it spins in a particular way. It has something called a gyromagnetic rotation, and that rotation changes, and the changes are referred to as percussion. Right, that's as deep as I would go into it. Now, the MRI machine is a big magnet. So if you look here, this yellow outer foil, that's a huge electromagnet, right? Now, the when you get to this level of magnetism, they use the term Tesla. Like 3 Teslas equals to 60,000 times the magnetic field of the Earth. Okay, so you have a little idea. So this little machine has to create a magnetic field that's 60,000 times stronger than the Earth in order to get these little atoms to behave in a different way. But when you apply the magnetic field, they all point in one direction generally. Some of them still point in the opposite direction, but they all line up linearly. Now, what they realize is that if you apply a radio frequency to this, so, I mean, these people were actually doing experiments and stuff they couldn't see, right? It's a whole different realm, whole different game. When they actually applied this radio frequency, they would actually change orientation now and rotate in a particular way, right? And of course, there are a lot of calculations as what they really measured, because they apply these things to our body, and then they listen, and they basically listen using the same, you see, this is a transceiver, the radio frequency thing that's around it, this little blue part here, it would emit a frequency, and then it would actually detect the resulting frequency. So what it would do, it would change the behavior of the atoms, and then when the frequency wasn't there, they would go back to the original position, right? But when they go back, they will emit an energy, right? A same radio frequency, a wave, and it will collect this wave like how an antenna collects radio frequencies, right? And then they would measure this. So they will do baseline, and then they'll do different frequencies and stuff. But what I want you to appreciate is like how it worked. It worked with basically a magnet, a radio frequency, and an echo detector, all right? This is a breakdown of how it works, but I'll kind of skip that because I sort of explained what it does, right? It's really looking at alignment, and because it's a little smaller, I'll skip it. All right, so we're looking at a little bit about how this machine evolved, right? It can be split up into three parts. The first part is, of course, the discovery of this thing called nuclear magnetic resonance. So there were a group of people who were not into the ionizing radiation business. They into atomic business and how it behaves in a magnetic field. So a whole different group of scientists. Then, of course, how could they put a machine together in order to view the brain? So a different set of people involved in designing this machine. Of course, now, how to optimize it, how to get it to actually give you the data that you're looking for, all right? So the scientists, you know, they go back all the way into the 1700s. This guy, Joseph Fourier, he was the guy who, and of course today there's an equation called the Fourier equation that is still used based on what he came up with, without a computer, by the way. All right, so he developed this thing called the Fourier transformation, right? Which is still being used today in the algorithms for MRI and fMRI. And of course, fMRI is like old tech now. You'll see by the end of this lecture, there are so many different mathematicians and computer programmers who are transforming the way the data is handled. So, you know, you'll see a table with a whole different types of machines that are all stemming off from this. Now, this guy, Wolfgang Pauli, yeah, he's the guy I have like a tremendous amount of respect for. Why? Well, he was a physicist, that was excellent, but this has been documented in history that age 18, he challenged the ideas of Einstein when it comes to the theory of relativity, which all of we know what it is, but not exactly the details of the theory of relativity, right? Anyhow, he wrote a paper when he was 18 and sent it to Einstein. And at that time, Einstein told him that he would want to get a Nobel Prize, which he did get in 1945, okay? So he had many theories that resulted in the invention of the MRI and fMRI. This guy, Wolfgang Pauli, because this is not a total description of who he is. He did many things throughout his lifetime. Unfortunately, he didn't live very long. Then we have Isidore Rabi. He did the first experiment that proved that the magnetic resonance. So the other guys thought of it, they did calculations for it, but it wasn't physical yet. But what he did, he took that theory and actually conducted experiments. So this man, he started bridging the gap, right? And he showed that there's this gyromagnetic ratio, the thing about how the atoms spin in different fields, right? He actually showed that it is present in elements, in atoms, right? So it's the theory and the knowledge is building up here. Then we get to these two guys now. Together, they independently demonstrate that in solids, you can have magnetic resonance and it can be measured. So they got together and they started working on this thing really strong. Erwin Hahn, he proposed the concept of the echo. Remember I told you that they have to emit the radio frequency, but then they have to listen to it. So he came up with the aspect of the device that would listen to it. And he proved that when you did emit a radio frequency to a biological system, it could get back a response, right? So he had another part of the puzzle. And of course, he had Paul Otterburg, who was the American chemist, who now developed the gradient magnets. Now, I didn't go into the gradient magnets, right? But the thing is, this is absolutely brilliant what they did. Because in the MRI machine, you have three magnets on the side, right? The X coil, the Z coil, and the Y coil. And what they are able to do now is to create a magnetic gradient. So one side of the field has a stronger field, and on the opposite side of the coil, have a weaker field. And that now, in three gradients, cause the atoms to behave differently when you emit the radio frequency. You see, the thing is, in one slice, when all the atoms behave the same, then you can't really get data to distinguish each one. And this was actually working with something called a voxel. It's not working with pixel, like picture elements. It's actually working with volume elements, right? And what you had now was the atoms in a particular volume, and this actually shows you that, well, it's, you know, you could get a grid and coordinates, right? So they wanted each one to behave differently. So with this magnetic gradient in each axis, you could now have the atoms in their gyroscopic behavior be different. There's a lot that I'm not going into, but I'm just kind of highlighting what was going on here with these five aspects, right? Now, what was even more interesting is that they could get baseline data for healthy tissue, but whenever there was a tumor in the tissue or something solid placed in the tissue, it actually showed up with a different behavior. And with normal tissue, what is even better than x-rays is that with x-rays, you look into the body and you're actually looking at different shades of gray, right? Contrast. So like bone will absorb a lot, it'll look white, but fat tissue would look a little gray, water-based tissue would look a little different, right? With this now, whenever there was a tumor, the density would be different and the atoms in it would be different. So the hydrogen atoms that's bonded to almost every single thing that's organic, like carbohydrates has atoms and hydrogens on it, proteins have hydrogens, lipids have hydrogens, right? And of course you have water which has hydrogen. So they're basically mapping the hydrogen behavior in all these different molecules in the body. And of course they would behave differently. But when there's a tumor, it would be very dense. So it would behave differently. So they actually figure out how to get data using magnetic resonance and the hydrogen atoms. And of course, today we'll use it for stroke, infections, developmental abnormalities. You see, like if you get a headache, you don't have a full-size tumor to shut down your physical function, but you could have a headache. You could have a tumor growing, right? So now with the MRI, we're not using ionizing radiation. So it is much safer. And of course, there's just magnetic stuff. The machine does vibrate, but it doesn't rotate and create that huge noise. So actually, people who are claustrophobic actually have a better time in this, right? And you will see that this will give you better data because of its elaborate design. Now, things that they couldn't do before, like with CT, you see, the brain has blood. The fat tissue and the blood and the CSF in the brain, they're all kind of like on the same level. So if a person did have traumatic brain injury and did have a bleed in their brain, CT can't pick it up. And of course, many people suffer accidents, right? So the CT had a lot of limitations. It was basically for anything that had calcification in it. The CT would do well. But if it was like soft tissue damage, we couldn't get data from it. Hence the big need for the MRI and eventually the fMRI. But you realize though, these are still doing structural imaging. We haven't gotten into the thing where you could look at a picture and see a change in the brain, right? That's what fMRI is. Now, this is just a quick comparison for the pros and cons that, of course, this uses ionizing radiation, which is bad. This doesn't, that's good. Excellent visualization of acute little bleed, but if you had big bleeds, it would kind of cover up the stuff. Just like how the skull covers up everything, the bleed would cover up everything below. Very sensitive to calcification, good. So if you had how often do you get a calcification tumor in your brain? Not very, but you get all different types of tumors, right? And then of course, with limited planes, basically, remember this was spinning around, but now with this, you could do X, Y, and Z. So in different axes, right? So it's much better. This had limited contrast. Well, you realize the shades of gray, right? But this actually, dense bone does not impose any limitation. Now, if you had a tumor right next to the bony tissue, you couldn't see it well either. So like down here inside the cranium, right? If you had a tumor down there, it wouldn't really pick it up well because it looked like bone, right? So what you would get is artifacts then, but you wouldn't be able to say for sure it's a tumor. All right, but the good thing about this though, this is quick and easy and inexpensive. In Trinidad, we do have a lot of CT scanners, right? Each one of the major hospitals have it, and some of the private hospitals like Centley has it, right? But when it comes to the MRI guy, how many do you think we have in Trinidad?
One.
Yeah, two. Two for sure. Three? Two? Yeah, one in Mount Hope and one in San Fernando. Because these machines are elaborate and expensive, right? But they do give better data, right? As you can see. All right, moving on. Mm-hmm. Excellent question, and it's coming up. I think you asked it at the right time. there's no evidence that I'm going to use pregnant women as an example because they are considered to be extremely delicate. You would not do ionizing radiation if a person is pregnant or a very small child even. Though if you have an accident and you have to use it, then you have to use it, right? But you won't just walk in and do a CT. So they say that it's no evidence that it's actually a bad thing. But there are some exceptions, of course. As you can see, if you're claustrophobic, you have to go into this whole magnetic tunnel, right? Well, of course, today we're doing whole body and not just your brain. If it's just your brain, you'll use your headpiece, right? But children and babies, of course, you can't move in any of these machines. So if a child has to do an MRI or a CT, it's recommended that they do general anesthesia, which is always the tricky thing because if the child is already sick, then you don't want to make them more sick, right? And of course, now anybody who has any one of these pacemakers here, any artificial joints, medical clips, any sort of implants in their body, obviously this magnetic force is strong, right? And there are some documented accidents that a person walked into the room while the MRI was going on with a hole in a paper that had a paper clip, and the paper clip ripped out of the paper and went straight through the nose into the brain of the person. So some crazy accidents like that. And of course, medical beds got sucked into the machine while people were in it. And little accidents here and there. Because you don't really hear it, right? It's kind of bad for the people. To get these things to work better, right, you could do contrast. So you could inject something into, like you might know about the angiogram, right? But of course, you can inject contrast material. Some people might be allergic to it and whatever. So then you have to do a little background. But basically, this is a good amount of limitations. You know, it doesn't categorically like isolate a whole group of people. Very few people will actually fall into this exception category. Well, that's why I'm here, to make sure you get some a better understanding of it.
Do people sell these things, the cups and
yeah.
samples and so
yes, on. Yes.
I'm sure those are very low.
Very, very low. Strength. Very low. Well, let me just give you a point to think about, right? I'm sure you're aware that every time you do a scientific experiment, like a medical experiment, you need this placebo group. And if you do not have this placebo group, then your data is not well recognized, right? Why is that?
Well, because what people think, we have an effect.
Precisely. So you wear this thing, and your brain tells you are getting better, and you see that we don't understand the power of this brain. And in some studies, like with cancer, 50% of the patients got better drinking water or taking water pills because they believe. So this placebo effect, we don't know the power of the brain. You know, this guy, Deepak Chopra, he wrote a book called The Super Brain. And in The Super Brain, he said that, see all this imaging stuff I'm talking about? Consider a cricket match going on in the oval. And you have the players, you have the stands full, and everybody talking. So think about the brain now. All the neurons talking, right? Now, we are trying to understand what's going on in the brain. But he said, what is really going on? We're trying to understand that as if we were outside with a stethoscope on the wall of the oval. Meaning that we can't possibly understand what each person is doing. But with 100 billion neurons, and of course all these modalities, we still aren't really understanding what neurons are doing on an individual basis or on a group basis. You know, but we're still trying, of course. All right. So these are some of the images that you could get from MRI. Now, what do you see here? Do you see anything crystal clear? Generally, no, you get blotches. Right, so we're jumping into fMRI now, functional, right? So I just skipped out of the MRI and CT, and I'm moving forward now to what we really want to appreciate. So structural was the first two. Now, number three, fMRI, functional MRI. What's going on in here is that they realize with all this magnetic stuff, they were basically looking at only at the hydrogen atom. And it's like, hey, let's use a bigger atom. Each hemoglobin molecule has the iron in it, right? So of course it changes when it gets oxygen and when it gives up the oxygen. And they realize now that they could use that because what's going on is that when hemoglobin is oxygenated, it's diamagnetic and it does not have a magnetic field. But when it's deoxygenated, it's paramagnetic and it has a magnetic field. So now they decided to use this because what they also realized, other neuroscientists showed, that obviously when a particular part of the brain is doing a particular activity, it requires more oxygen. Now, today we know that the brain actually will never ever turn on every part totally. Two things would happen. It would use too much, it would produce too much heat, and of course it wouldn't have enough energy to supply it. So what the brain does is turn on little parts at a time and do all its functions, but it's always like a flickering light in different parts of it, right? And that's how it works. But anyhow, whenever it does light up, in reality, it would use more oxygen. And they could therefore now use this magnetic field on or off to get information, right? And of course, all of this is kind of being hinged now on a new concept, which will come in more when I go through the EEG and MEG, that whenever you have electrical activity, you'll have a magnetic force.
So the
age-old
question,
mm-hmm.
How much of our brain do we use at any one point in time?
Well, to fully explain that to you in the quickest time as possible, right? If a person has Parkinson's disease, they lose, take about 1 millimeter cubed, right? That amount of brain volume, and you can't move anymore. So if you lose a speck, right, and you have such debilitating disease, what do you think about how much percent we use? Every single ounce of that brain tissue is working. Yeah, yeah, Morgan Freeman and Lucy, I mean, yeah, that was like rubbish, right? Rubbish in the sense that you use 10% of your brain, and therefore if you turn on the other parts, the other parts are always working, always working. You'll get that by the time we finish here, right? It's always working. If you lose a small speck, then it cannot harness that in its electrical pathways, all right? Yeah, it's always working. You can't lose any part of it. But what they're supposed to say, though, is that we use the frontal cortex, and not all of us use 100% of the frontal cortex. Some of us use parts of it, you see. So if they were to say that from the frontal cortex, we use 10% of that volume, then okay, fine, we could extrapolate. And if you do try to learn more things and use both sides, because eventually you'll realize if you follow neuroscience that you use one half of your brain, generally speaking, right? Because if you're right-handed, then the opposite side is more developed. But if you learn to be ambidextrous, then the two sides will be equally developed. And they said that was the basis of Einstein's intelligence, that he would do task that would involve both sides. So he tried to always, or if you were thinking about maths, he would go play the violin. So always doing opposite things to equalize. Okay. With fMRI now, these were the people who actually came up with it. And this is very recent technology, 1990. Unfortunately, I didn't see many of them getting Nobel Prizes for some reason. But anyhow, both of them got together and they demonstrated this blood oxygen level demand thing that can be harnessed for imaging the brain with respect to functioning. So that was the major thing, right? Because we wanted to know, like for example, a person in a coma, do you pull the plug or not? Is the person actually brain dead or not? We couldn't figure that out. But with fMRI, we can, because now we could tell that if the person is shown a picture or they see like a relative or something and they have a new brain pattern, hey, the brain is working. Don't unplug, because it could recover. We never know, right? It'll just take time. But if you do all of that, you show them pictures, you play music, you do all sorts of things that, you know, could stimulate them, and there's no response, well, okay, then. Now we could actually do that type of analysis, right, when it comes to functioning. So the advantages of this is the new realm of functional imaging now. We could see a map in the brain, and now we could actually use that map as baseline for healthy people and unhealthy people. And you'll see, in this stage now, we started to characterize schizophrenia and depression. Like, we were sure those things were clinical diseases before. Like, I mean, you'll tell everybody they're mad, right? But of course, now we have scientific proof, okay, that they're crazy. Because they would have a different pattern based on this whole brain mapping thing, right? Okay. There are some limitations to it, but the limitations were actually, today, they are overcome. Many of them, right? And what you would see, though, is that what they're trying to do is to use blood flow to appreciate how a tissue is being turned off or turned on, right? Meaning it's functional or not. But when you consider the amount of capillaries versus the amount of brain tissue, it's like you have one capillary to a lot of brain tissue. So if you're using this volume thing with giving off oxygen and picking up, you're actually not zoning in very well. So what it had was low spatial resolution. You see, like 5 millimeters in the brain is like a couple thousand neurons. A whole different pathway. So therefore now, you were just, with the red glows, right, you were grouping neurons, right? You could see activity, but it was too blurry. So it had low spatial resolution, right? And it also had a kind of lowish, but good enough temporal resolution, because it didn't take too long for, like for example, if you showed somebody a picture, within a short period of time, a couple seconds, 9 seconds or so, then you'll see the change in the brain, right? To match up with the pattern. So it was a slight delay. Of course, 9 seconds is plenty, because neurons fire at microseconds, right? So that's still plenty limitations there. All right, But this is a basic example of what could have been done, what can be done now with, and was not able to do before without the technology, right? Like healthy controls, you'll see that they have these particular signature patterns, right? But of course, now a person with depression, you notice the specs are changing. And this is totally different to the brain with schizophrenia, you see? So these areas are lighting up. You notice it is just one little spot, but here, big spot, depression. So depression is a real disease. Do not think yourself into depression. Do not stay negative all the time. That's one of the side off points from this lecture, right? Because you could create depression. Yes, it could be genetic and whatever, and it could be situational, but it could also be self-imposed. All right, so the evolution of the fMRI now. This is the exciting part of this talk, because now we're into 2001, it's our time, right? And what the scientists were able to do in like this decade and a half was crazy, because they come up with something else now, isotropic diffusion. So now you're going to see a big D in front of the fMRI. That's diffusion fMRI. They didn't only realize that more oxygen goes into the brain, but they also realized that the size of the neurons and the brain matter, it swells, basically. So now one says that there's a swelling that's going on in the brain. We didn't know about it before, right? And now they can measure that swelling along with the oxygen. So that's the whole thing with dFMRI. Now the brain swells pretty fast. It swells in like 2.3 seconds, right? So now we had higher temporal resolution with this modern day technology thing. And what we have now is more precise spatial and temporal. So we could see the response. If it could detect the change faster, then most likely it's associated. You see, if you show someone a picture, right, and you want to know if they're having certain emotions associated with that picture, you can show them the picture, but then they could remember something else and their mind could go off and you're like, we can't stay focused. So really and truly, again, a picture, but you're not too sure what the brain is actually doing at that time, right? Because you have a time delay. So you could have seen the picture, it's like, I don't like a person, and then you start thinking about something else, what are they going to do next? So the thought patterns are rapidly changing, so you have to have a quick data acquisition system, right? And 2 to 3 seconds, that's okay, but we're not at micro milliseconds yet, which is what neurons fire at, right? As a matter of fact, there's a new LS unit of measurement for how fast neurons. So they have their own scale because they're so quick, right? Okay, now what has facilitated all this drama? And of course, the talk is on evolution of technology. Back in the 1980s, 85, the strength of the magnetic force was like 1 Tesla, right? So that's about, let's say, 30,000 times the strength of the Earth, right? But then in recent time, well, of course, we like to go extreme, so we went from 1 to like 4 to like 7, and now, well, it's projected somewhere. Like right now, we're supposed to have a 12 Tesla machine. Beware, right? Like within meters of that machine, you will have warning signs. Or even walk nearby with a pen, it could like kill you, you know? It could get sucked out and stuff with the machine as well. So like you have to zone out that whole area of the hospital to make sure, right? With a 12 Tesla, I mean, we're talking like probably, if you know, like 5 Tesla is like 60,000. So we're talking over 100,000 times the strength of the Earth. Obviously, this machine needs a lot of current. Okay, so you have to have special backups on it. Anyhow, this what is this graph showing you is that the voxel-based morphometry, remember that this MRI thing is based on voxels and calculating tomometric slices, volume, to get your image. But now, remember the diffusion thing with the expansion? Over time, you see, like in recently up to 2010, this is a reflection of the number of papers published, right? And you see like people kind of phasing out from the whole MRI thing and they're phasing into the diffusion tensor imaging. So it's like imaging is going to head in a particular direction. So if you want to choose a particular field, well, get onto the dfMRI and not the old school MRI thing, right? Like if you want to do a master's or something. Okay, this is what the initial machines actually were able to do. And this is what your modern dfMRI is. The picture isn't doing justice, but what we could see now is that neuronal pathways actually have bands of fibers that connect in a precise way. And that whole 10% of your brain, if you follow the blue thing, this is now showing you that when you think of something, your memory part will be connected. Then your sensory cortex, then if you're going to analyze it, the frontal cortex. Then if it had a color, then the visual cortex. If that object had a sound, the temporal cortex. So your whole brain now jumps in on a single thought. It's not like, okay, only the frontal part of your brain, so you could slice out the other 90% and be fine.
So has any of these imaging been done or performed on, say, the brain while it's at rest?
Yeah. a lot has been done, and of course there's, well, I just want to keep time because I don't want to keep you too long, but I'll answer that question directly after that. A certain analysis was done of sleep, and this guy discovered something amazing which actually makes sense, right? But sleep, we don't know why it is important. We have a whole bunch of ideas that was it good for, but we know for one thing, if you don't sleep for 8 days, you die. Right, the brain will do every single thing to fall asleep during those 8 days. But of course, if you do experiment with primates and you keep waking them up all the time, they die after 8 days. So something is, I mean, sleep is mandatory, right? But what actually chemically goes on, we're not too sure.
Question, I think in 2012, there's a paper, kind of university, I think, so somewhere in the States.
Okay.
You see that men thought, well, fronts to back and women thought men, right?
Yes, it's been studied. Yes, the brain pattern of a woman is totally different. For certain aspects, yes, they do think differently. That's why we can never figure them out and they can never figure us out. You know, it is different. So that's a good thing, yes. But of course, now we base that on these colors. So that is a kind of like a stretch, right? But yes, they did many different psychological experiments and they found that women will think differently, right? And just to interject on a side note, if you want to learn a lot about this, BBC actually does a lot of informative documentaries on these aspects, right? So if you look up BBC and the brain, you'll get like a whole lot of one-hour videos explaining things, right? Okay, right, so back to business now. We went through X-ray, CT, MRI, fMRI, dfMRI, and now we're talking about single photon emission. This is a whole different thing. We're back into a kind of radiation scenario. So this other group of individuals, they realize now, if you use radioactive isotopes, they would emit energy, and when they bombard the tissues, they would collide with electrons and annihilate the electrons and eventually produce gamma rays. So now we switch into a gamma detection system, not X-ray detection system, right? We're not using magnetic resonance anymore. So this is the whole concept of nuclear medicine. You see, this added a third variable. Before, we wanted to see structural, then we wanted to see function, right? But what if we wanted to do treatment? You can't just jump into the brain, dissect out a tumor, and say, all right, no problem, it'll just heal itself and fill it back. No, it doesn't work like that, right? So you needed to actually get something inside the brain, target the tumor, destroy the tumor, and you want to image it while it's being destroyed. And that was the benefit of now this single photon emission SPECT, right? Because what they have is certain radioactive isotopes that would emit single photons. And you can detect those photons, right? Because it will, after interaction, it will become gamma rays, and you have like a Geiger counter, which detects like radiation in different places. It's easy to detect, you know, it's very sensitive. Right, so what you have is a very sensitive gamma computer, right? And of course, technetium T99, that's the most favored isotope for doing a whole bunch of different detection. So with this now, you could, well, of course, this has to do now with radiopharmaceuticals. So now we jump back into a problem where how much radiation is good, how often you can take this treatment, will it damage normal tissue? So you realize now we're able to treat, but then we have a flaw again, right? You could put yourself at risk, but of course, the good thing about it, they've designed these radioisotopes to actually like emit radiation for like up to 6 hours. So it's not really bad, but again, you wouldn't recommend it for pregnant women or babies or anything, right? Okay, so the guy who was, this is recent tech, 1963, he's still alive, age 86. So, I mean, I kind of admire these guys because you are able to live through the time and see how it transformed lives. You know, that's why I'm excited about all these stories, you know. But they were able to develop the first SPECT scanner. So, again, these guys dealing with radiation, and he lived up to 86. That's an interesting thing, right? the application now. Before they were using contrast, right? But in order to detect the contrast, it's like if you're trying to make your blood vessels into bone, right? It would absorb a lot of radiation. So you put in a molecule that would absorb a lot of radiation into the patient, and then they move around, right? Some people are allergic to the contrast, so it had to be used carefully. This is not totally, of course, free of harm, but what is going on here now is that you could now, instead of putting a lot of contrast, you could put a little bit of radioactive molecule, and it would give you better images. Right? And like certain diseases now, this didn't come up. Schizophrenia came up, depression came up, but not Alzheimer's, right? This actually gives the ability to start to decode what is going on functionally with people with Alzheimer's disease. If you have seen the movie Still Alice, everybody saw that movie? You will get an idea that anybody can be struck down with Alzheimer's disease and how debilitating and devastating it is. I mean, literally, you forget yourself, right? We'll talk about the guy at the end who I'm saving up for, that his memory is about 30 seconds. 30 seconds. So if his wife steps out of the room and she steps back in, oh my God, I haven't seen you in ages. And that's how he falls in love every time she steps out and steps into the room. Yes, certain things he remember, all right? That's a nice story to wrap up with. All right, the applications for SPECT, of course, now, so far, right, we weren't able to go very deep into the brain with all the imaging stuff. Even with the fMRI, you notice it was very cerebral, more to the surface. Now, since these molecules are radiating and they could go a little deeper, right, the detection could penetrate the brain deeper, all right? So, and other subtle diseases now, like things like dementia popping up back, so you could actually do multimodal. For seizures, so people who had seizures, you could do SPECT to actually understand what's going wrong. People who are in a coma, well, this is a good way to actually figure it out, because you really have to, they don't have to be very participative in this thing. You inject them and then you just put them in the machine and you see what's happening, right? Okay, and of course now, mood disorders, attention deficit disorder. So every single child in the US is probably going for a SPECT scan, you know, because they really have ADD across there, you know? A child who misbehaves. Anyhow, and inflammatory diseases now came onto the list of being detected. So you didn't know. Basically, we are transforming from the part of history where it was tumor and cancer-based to now including other diseases, right? Because we're dealing more with accumulation of this in tissues. And of course, in normal brain, it would diffuse in a particular way, right? But in a brain that's losing tissue, it would actually be void in certain areas. So you could look at voids better too, all right? With respect to SPECT, you could see now that the images are much better, and this is showing you a normal person, and this is how the radioisotope will accumulate in certain areas in a person with schizophrenia, and how it would accumulate in different areas, not here so much, but here the hotspots are like where you have more accumulation, and you could actually get signature patterns for your schizophrenia versus your normal person, right? Well, this is just mapping the difference, the total difference between the two. All right, shifting again. That was SPECT. Now we're looking at positron emission. So this is where you have a radioactive isotope, and of course you could use fluorine, nitrogen, oxygen, carbon. It would integrate now into the system. So now it is not only going to stay in the blood, it's going to be picked up by the tissues. So we're actually looking at molecules going into cells now, a new realm of imaging, right? Because you could actually tell if the tumor is there and the cells around it are working, maybe the tumor not so bad. But if the cells around the tumor are dying and they're not functioning, they're not picking up as much glucose as they should as normal tissue, then you could assess now, hey, you need surgery immediately because, you know, the tissue around your tumor is dying, right? So that's roughly what the capability of PET scanning is. And how it works really, you would have an electron being produced and it will collide with the electrons in the tissue, right? Well, actually it's a positron, right? So certain radioactive isotopes emit positrons and positrons will collide with electrons in the tissue, and the electrons, when they do positron and electron positive, well, a positron is a positive electron, so when equal forces collide, they annihilate and then it produces gamma radiation, which is picked up by this gamma detector. That's basically how it works. Then you use a computer to generate the images, right? Tomography. Okay. These were the guys now, Mr. Sweet and Brunel. They came up with the whole idea of this positron emission technology. Now, this is kind of hard stuff, you know, because you're dealing with radioactive isotopes, you know, and you're trying to understand what it does when it goes into a living system. So you always have to be sweeping Geiger counters, have to make sure everything, no gamma radiation anywhere, make sure you're not carrying it home. It was a difficult time for them. But of course, in 1975, they wanted to do more, right? I mean, we had in the early 1900s, the CT came about and then it evolved, right? But a new bit of technology. Well, this actually shows you how it evolved over time. With the first set of PET scanners, that's what it looked like. It's like, okay, we're not really doing much here because you get like blobs, right? So of course, now they wanted to improve this. So from 1975 to 77, 78, 1995, we are where we want to be. But of course, they're still pushing this machine now. to get HD resolution so we could do better volumetric analysis. So basically we could say, all right, you have a small brain, or you have a big brain, or you have the brain of a killer, because your psychopathic brain map is in your head. And if you have this now, so this whole thing is creating a new realm of psychology now, clinical psychology based on brain imaging.
Is that
well, not really, right? Because consider this, right? They're going around to the prisons and mapping all these people's brains to a motorist and stuff, right? So now they have a template because they collect a lot of data and they average the brain map on what should be, right? So you have this little child going to school and take an image, you're like, whoa, he have the brain map of a killer. What are you going to do, put him in jail?
Or
yeah, you know? So.
Just to answer something, so does that mean to say for the psychiatric disorders,
mm-hmm.
Schizophrenia, memory loss,
etc., yeah.
Well,
currently, yes, they're trying to classify. Like one guy, he did like 4,000 children who came to him complaining about attention deficit disorder. And what he found, like the children, he could group them into 4 categories, right? So that's good in treatment. And now you would treat and you would see if it reverts to a normal brain pattern. So it is now actually doing non-invasive, non-ionizing radiation. With this spec, you do have a bit of radiation, right? But it's much less than your CT scan. So you could actually get children a little bit involved in it, right? And use it to assess children. So the SPECT and the PET, yes, a lot of children get these type of images done. And he has a psychiatric clinic, and he's trying to sort them out. So what you do now is get the patterns, treat them, and see if it's reverting.
So it's definitely consistency
with disorder. Yeah. Yeah, we weren't able to actually identify it before, yeah. But we can now.
Mm-hmm. There was a study that said that C-level employees,
mm-hmm.
those CEOs of these large firms, have tendencies that would be similar to some of these violent persons, because every day, if you are CEO of a large international conglomerate,
mm-hmm.
and a particular business unit is losing money, say, all right, cool. Shut down that thing, like those people who, and you go ahead to your deal normal, you go and think about it.
The kind of decisions.
Yeah, decisions, because you can't really have too much emotion over, well, this man have 6 months ago to go for his pension.
Yes, you realize that, I mean, even though we try really hard, which is my summer point, we really still like the guy with the stethoscope listening to the match in the Oval. Like, we really have an idea, a better idea, but we really haven't decoded it just yet, you know? All right, so this kind of compares now, comparative thing about the PET and the SPECT as simplistic as possible. This uses positron, okay, this uses photon, no problem. This uses isotopes, this also uses isotopes. The slight negative part about this is like they have a longer half-life, they have a shorter half-life, so this is good. But the problem is though, we cut down the effect on the patient, but then it's not so sensitive, so the data we get have a lower spatial resolution. So the image a little blurry, as you were seeing, right? Low spatial resolution, but it's quite cheap and easy. So to do SPECT, this actually came out first, the more modified version is the PET. So that's like the MRI versus the CT. You also have the distinctions here, right? Well, we're close to the end, though, if you're worrying. I'm not too sure how much time went by. But yeah, I'm very close to the end because I just have to do EEG and MEG, right? So no worries, we're wrapping up. So what is EEG? It's an electroencephalogram that measures the activity of large numbers of populations of neurons. So what they do, they actually put an electrode onto the skull and try to measure the electrical activity. Now, like I said earlier, whenever you have electrical activity, you do have a magnetic behavior also. So they try to merge these two in order to get data, right? The good thing about the EEGs is like it's widely used. You can plant an EEG on anybody, like children. Now, some children, you know, they're not speaking yet. They kind of, you know, age 5, age 6, and you're kind of wondering now, is something really wrong? The easiest technology of them all to get an idea of what's going on in the brain is to do EEGs. Now, luckily for us, though, EEGs also has seen its evolution. They started off with just like putting one or two electrodes on the body, but remember the technology for actually doing an EKG, you can measure the electrical activity on the surface. Well, the EEG is more or less the same thing. But the thing about it is, though, in the body, you have bands of fibers, right? More diffused. In the brain, it's condensed. So therefore now, to see one of those bands, you need a really, really, really tiny electrode. And that's what the technology has been trying to evolve over time, right? Okay. Now, the good thing about this is that you can measure the voltage and the electrical activity in now milliseconds. So you realize we're crossing a temporal resolution barrier here with this, right? Because it can pick up changes fast. You see, once the neuron fires, it has electrical activity. There's no time delay there. But of course, it's how much neurons you need to emit that electrical activity for you to measure it. But like we saw earlier, if you're measuring a large volume of the brain, then you're not too sure what function this part is doing versus that part. All right, this was the guy, so Hans Berger, he's the guy who kind of like was behind the whole EEG, and these guys were studying these things. I mean, you trying to measure this magnetic force that is extremely low. Luckily for the heart, that set a good example, then they extrapolated the brain, right? So they know it is possible. So they kept looking, kept trying to improve, right? Okay, so this is what is really done, that whenever you have neurons carrying out some electrical activity, true, and of course again, once again with this, now you have cranium getting in the way, that reduces the electrical activity, okay? And when I compare MEG, you'll see why they created MEG versus EEG, right? Using magnetic, this is trying to get an electrical response, and then of course brain waves. Now this actually has worked out quite well, because there are beta waves, gamma waves, theta waves, and they're associated with different behaviors, right? So like when you're asleep, you have big beta waves, and then when you're awake, you have alpha waves, so it is possible, right? But to really say that, okay, you could diagnose stuff, it's kind of tricky. So therefore, this technology has to be improved, right? The advantages of it, you have, brilliant, high temporal resolution. Less motion artifacts. With the CT, you better stay still, because the minute you move, it's going to get blurry. With the MRI, same thing. The fMRI, same thing. Positron, don't move. But with this now, you're putting the electrodes on your head, so obviously you can move around and think. So therefore, children, non-invasive, you could actually get a little idea of, you know, something that's going on in their brain, right? For people who are claustrophobic, you wear a hat, you're good to go, right? And of course, it could be used on infants. You wouldn't believe how much congenital malformation there are with brains of children. You know, and some of them are induced, right? Like one guy with the SPECT, he analyzed a certain group of children, and one particular case that he wrote about was a boy who was an adolescent boy who had ADD, couldn't focus at all, right? And something, when he did the scan, he realized brain was not shaped properly. And of course, he tried to do a relationship with the history the child had, and the child had a fall when the child was young, and of course, that caused a bleed that wasn't detected and whatever, and the cranium is actually, the cerebrum is actually shaped kind of funny, and that's why he has behavioral problems now, because it was up in front. So head blows to the front of a child's head is serious stuff, right? Because a child's brain is actually growing still until they get to, like, well, I'll just use puberty as a cutoff point roughly, but there's a lot of development in the younger years of a child, right? You have to protect their brain because the cranium is much softer. All right, disadvantages, weak spatial. Like I said, you're measuring the electrical activity from a couple thousand neurons and then looking at what you're getting with this, right? So you're basically doing patches of neurons. So wherever now you have different pathways happening, you're not sure if it's pathway one or pathway two that's giving you a signal. So it wasn't very precise, right? Of course now, like I said, the benefit is that you can do it on children to see how they are, if certain parts of the brain are actually working. But we went from these few electrodes to this. And of course I read recently that I think you could put like over 500 electrodes onto a person, right? And with the Walk Again program by Miguel Nicolelis, yeah, he's pushing the limits now, because what we want to do with EEG is not so much diagnostic anymore, robotics. We want to use brain power to control machines. So now they're trying for robotics, off topic, but that's what they're doing with the electrodes now, so that if you can think of something, then you can move something robotically, right? Because they know which part of the brain would send that. They'll write an algorithm and then make the computer actually execute. All right, last one on our stop here for our history talk, right? MEG, what is MEG, right? Measures the changes in magnetic fields. So when your neuron actually fires, there's a really, really, really tiny magnetic field. So you need a really, really big magnet on your head to measure it, okay? So this, they've been trying over the years to improve this. But what's good with this? You basically sit in a chair, and now you could watch movies, you could watch pictures, you could do maths, and what they're doing now is seeing which part of your brain gets excited with all the neuronal activity and the impulses, right? So yes, it does help. And what happens now, this really big magnet, it measures the rapid neuronal impulses. So you have really good spatial resolution. So now you're realizing some days we have good spatial, some days we have bad spatial, sometimes we have good temporal, sometimes we have bad temporal. It's like we haven't struck the sweet spot yet with a machine that would do everything. So now comes, well, of course, this was the guy who, David Cohen, who was behind developing that machine, you know. So the reason why I'm showing you all this, because I see my picture somewhere there in some part of the history book sometime, you know, like doing some good. I'm not too sure yet, right? Anyhow, we enter this now new thing. We realize any one of them is not going to give us what we want. So of course now the modern people, the people of the last decade, have decided now to merge all the technologies with computers. So the programmers, the mathematicians, all those people and who designing like chips and whatever, well, of course, respect to all of these people because they are now facilitating neuroimaging, right? So what is multimodal neuroimaging? It is the merger of the data from MEG superimposed on an MRI. See, the MRI, this has low spatial but good temporal. And this now, the spatial is fine. The temporal, well, actually, not so good, right? So when you merge these two, perfect background with no data on it about functionality. But that wasn't good enough, right? We could actually merge it with EEG and fMRI and other techniques, right? This is something infrared, where they actually shine a bright infrared light and hopefully it penetrates the skull, so I'm not too excited about that one. And then something happens and they measure the effect or whatever, right? These guys are not too sure if their infrared business is going well. Anyhow, what do we see about multimodal neuroimaging? Well, early, not really, but this is showing you that the searches for multimodal and neuroimaging and multimodal and, of course, neuroimaging. Just to summarize, with those things, you can see within 2014 is shooting up. So therefore, if you want to become a person involved with this, whether you're in programming or you're in engineering or whatever, it would be good if you follow the electronics and the computerization of it, because that is the next wave. These people will obviously get a lot of jobs because now the companies will be hiring people to write programs in order to incorporate all these different things. So biomedical engineers, mathematicians, people doing physics, chemistry, whatever, that's where it's headed when it comes to brain imaging. And of course, we haven't figured out the brain yet. So if you get on board in that exciting aspect, well, you'll probably be part of the history. Okay, this is really small as well. I was kind of begging for a bigger screen in the beginning, but I'll walk you through it, right? This is fMRI, and what these axes are is basically, this is spatial temporal resolution. So you realize with fMRI, you have good spatial, right? But then with sMRI, that's something new that came on board. I didn't want to include it because we'll be here for much longer. But that, as you can see in this area, doesn't have much. So functional capacity, limited, but good spatial, right? So what this article actually did is try to compare like dMRI, that's the diffusion thing, the expansion thing, that does good with spatial because you can tell when the brain is swelling, it's actually functioning. With PET, you get good spatial. With EEG, you are reducing your spatial and you're moving a bit to the side. And of course, well, this is a safety axis, right? So they kind of plot out the most important points, right? With respect to this, I kind of urge you to look up the article. It's a 2015 article. It's the most recent article on neuroimaging, right? By Lou S., multimodal neuroimaging. And you'll get an idea of what they're really doing. Now, this is what we want. You see, when you take this and merge it onto this and that and so forth, and you bring all of them together, you get this. And that's what we want, and that's what we are able to get today, 2016. That if a person does different tests, and we use a computer program to bring it together, then we could actually understand spatially and functionally what's happening in the brain, right? This is now practical scenarios where it's been used in particular diseases. So we could say, all right, if a person has stroke, then it's not important if you do all these other scans, but if you do these two, then with multimodal, we'll be able to actually appreciate what happened in your brain as a result of that stroke. And of course, the same thing can be done. So they have these templates now for physicians and neurosurgeons and whoever to use to recommend now, hey, if you have a brain tumor, do PET, do sMRI, and do dMRI. And then we could actually figure out exactly volumetrically and functionally what's going on with your tumor. So now diagnosis and also treatment, they could map the shrinking down to very, very tiny changes in volume because we're looking at cells here and a tumor doesn't really shrink much when it's dying, right? So in the initial stages, to know if your treatment is working, this is very, very critical, that you could image your brain non-invasively, see how it's responding to your treatment, right? And of course, multiple sclerosis, bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, connectome, right? The connectome is like trying to analyze all the connections in your brain and see if it's working. So if you really wanted to understand if a child's brain developed well or not, the connectome, the way it connects, and the brain maps that it would have would be different from a person with a normal one, right? Okay. This, of course, is the modalities. We have sMRI, dMRI, fMRI, PET, and EEG and MEG, right? And with computers now, we could actually bring all of that together. And of course, this is for people who want to get into the field of engineering when it comes to writing programs. You will see that you could be involved in any one of these new fields that are popping up, right? And multimodal computing methods, all right? And of course, well, you also have programs. This is a long table that I took from an article, right? But basically, to understand sMRI, you would need a whole bunch of different programs, right? But what is being done now is that you have these all integrated programs that could actually do everything. So if you get your hands on one, this program, then it can replace all these. So that's where we're headed when it comes to computer and neuroimaging. So companies now are writing programs to cover all. So you could use it with the fMRI or CT scanners or PET scans. You just put in the data and they'll give you images and what you need, right? And of course, while we have these new communities are popping up, you know, I belong to the NAMIC group because, you know, they are into doing sMRI data analysis, see? So it's a whole new world that is opening up. And let's just do a comparison now of companies. So if you think about marketing, before 1981, we only had EMI, Medical Industries, funded by the Beatles. But now we have all these companies that are making neuroimaging machines. And I only talk about functional and topical stuff, right? I didn't go in details. Like, for example, the confocal microscope, fluorescent microscope, right? TEM, transition micro. All these microscopes are actually following along in their evolution also. So it's a huge field of imaging equipment, not only for what I've spoken about. Right, so the last two classical cases, and then, well, I will close off. This guy, right, Henry Molaison. He had really, really, really bad epilepsy. So he couldn't really do anything, and he was a real hazard to himself and other people, right? So he was referred for a particular type of surgery. So on this side, you will see that you have these two little parts of the brain, right? So they decided that with all electrical activity, so this is in 1953, not so much of the technology was available, so they didn't know what to do and what not to do. So the neurosurgeon suspected that with the limited technology they had, that he had a disarray in this part of the brain and therefore it should be cut off. So this was the first experiment. You see, with Phineas Gage, he lost a part of the brain and he was still okay, right? Well, not fully okay, but you know, he could walk and talk and be fine, right? So if they stop his epileptic events, then he'd be fine. So they cut it off. And you can see here, this is his brain missing this part, right? And then, unfortunately, they realized that he had significant memory loss. Why? Because they cut off a part of the brain that sits in here called the hippocampus. And as with that accident, then they realized, aha, you see, this is what they were doing in 1950 with all this tech, without all this functional technology. They were guessing. This structure, okay, probably we don't need it. Let's cut it out. Uh-oh, what happened? He lost his memory. Really bad memory, right? He died eventually after the surgery. Well, not a little while after the surgery. But this was a classic case where you did something invasive, and then in a human, and you follow the case afterwards, learn in real time the association of that brain structure with function, right? And when he died, obviously, well, the neuroscientists were up for grabs on his brain. Immediately, they started to cut it up. And they realized that not only in the part that he was missing, that he had problems, but now they realized that in other parts of his brain, so you can see, like, there are little holes here. You're not supposed to have those little holes. Those little holes are lesions, right? And his brain was actually dying away. So that was another part. That had another part to play with him losing his memory. All right, so I hope you enjoyed that little talk on the history and the evolution of medical imaging. And well, I just want to close, so this is my last line, on what I want to do with respect to being at, you know, the wonderful biomedical engineering unit. And of course, admiring all these great scientists. Of, I want to be like those. And I was very excited when I got the job opportunity at UTT because there isn't a section that does neuroscience. So in my interview and stuff, we were discussing about someday I would, you know, try to facilitate or encourage or help build the capacity of UTT to have something like a master's in neuroscience. But recently I was discussing with my supervisor that we could probably even go further and look for grants and be able to bring down fMRI technology here and neuroimaging technology. Eventually even have a department that does neuroimaging. We could do two things. We would better train our graduates, but we will also produce, like create an industry for neuroimaging so that patients could be referred to us. But being the professionals, the biomedical engineers, we will obviously be able to produce excellent data for these people who need it because, I mean, if you're wrong in this department, you're messing up somebody's brain. And when somebody's brain is messed up, yeah, that's the whole person being messed up, you know? So someday, of course, I hope that I will be involved and, well, younger students, by the time we get this on stream, we'll be the pioneers and we'll be one of those pictures in a history talk someone later on will be given that we facilitated it in Trinidad and Tobago, the whole expansion of neuroscience and neuroimaging. So thank you very much for your time, your attention. I did go over time a little bit.